Good morning. Good morning. Ah, now, okay, better. So I have a question for you. Do you think it's important to define what a winery is? In the conversation we're going to have after my presentation, one of the questions I'm going to ask you is, what is a winery? You may want to think about your answer carefully. So I have a presentation that I'm hoping they'll put on the board, because if not, I'll have to talk for 45 minutes. Yes? There we are. Okay, so I'm going to talk you through a little bit of how not just the Napa Valley, because when it comes to family tourism, the Napa Valley is not the leader. One of the decisions that was made back in 1994 in the Napa Valley was, we want to control tourism very carefully. And so we prohibit many of the things you're about to see because we want to be careful and not create an area, a region that no longer has vineyards. All it has is amusement parks. So, why do people travel? As I have been known to say, wine tourism, what you are studying for the next 2 years, does not exist. There is no such thing as wine tourism. There is only tourism. What's the difference between a wine tourist and another tourist? No difference. No difference. So please don't think about wine tourism as being something very special and very different. Your job is to convince the wine industry that tourism is tourism, and it is not an attempt to pass the WSET Advanced Curriculum in Wine Appreciation. So, if you want to explain who you are and what you are to tourists, you have to focus on these elements: essence and difference. One difference between tourism and regular life: regular life is work, tourism is fun. If you make tourism work, you've lost the distinction. Tourism is new experiences. There's a wonderful saying in English, a change is as good as a rest. Doing something new is as invigorating as resting. Here is the same when I travel, when I visit, when I go on tours. That's different. I love this quote from Ibn Battuta. Do we know who Ibn Battuta is? Does anyone know who Ibn Battuta is? Nobody? Okay, you should be studying people like Ibn Battuta. An Arabic traveler of about the year 900, 1000. Traveling, it leaves you speechless and then turns you into a storyteller. He traveled the world before Facebook. And when we come back from our trips, what do we tell? We tell stories about people, not about things. People love telling stories about themselves. Ooh, you know what we did? If there is one explanation for the success of Facebook, Facebook exists because people like to say, look at me and look at what I am doing. That's Facebook, and that's what they talk about in tourism. And of course, they talk about experiences they had. We talked about essential experiences. We talk about people wanting to have an experiential tourism. What's the essence of a region? You know? If I come to Tarragona and I stay in a modern international hotel and for breakfast I have eggs Benedict. This is not essential tourism. This is international globalization tourism, and there is no difference. There is no new experience, and it's not why I travel. But when I come to Tarragona and I go down to the port and I have rice with mariscos, that's essential tourism. That's understanding what is the essence of the region. So, you'll hear me say this over and over again. Is the essence of a region rocks and rainfall? Terroir? Is it statistics? Is it dates and battles? Again, my father was a history professor. Dates and battles were big things. No. Is that the essence of Priorat? I don't think so. You cannot capture it by analysis. Who's a geologist? This must be fascinating for them. That is not why we travel. We travel. The world is a book, and those who do not travel read only one page. What a wonderful, wonderful comment, huh? Yeah. Another way I explain the United States to the rest of the world is 25% of Americans have passports. This explains our foreign policy perfectly. You know, most people in America think traveling is going from Minnesota to Florida. So what's the essence of a region? It's the culture. And culture is the expression of the human spirit, the communal human spirit. If you want to understand a culture, look at the cathedral. The cathedral in Laon, in France, there are cows on the bell towers of the cathedral. Why are there cows on the bell towers of the cathedral? Because the farmers in the medieval years, when they were constructing that cathedral, said, "You are making this cathedral on our backs, and we want to be remembered for eternity that we helped build this cathedral. If you don't put cows on the towers, we're not working anymore." Towers on, cows in the towers, only in Laon. It's a wonderful cathedral. Anyone know where this is? Excellent, it's Burning Man. Burning Man is a desert. There are no services within 100 kilometers. And for one weekend in September, it becomes the largest imagination, art, and architecture festival in the world. And at the end of the week, they burn everything down, take everything away, and it is as if it never existed. But it is absolutely an expression of creativity and imagination. So is that. And for me, at 2 o'clock, I'd rather have this than that. But that's just me, okay? Wine is an expression of the human spirit. It's impossible to make wine with one person. You need a group. You need a group to plant the vines. You need a group to build the building. You need a group to harvest the grapes. It's a communal expression of culture. It's like a chorus. It's like a string quartet. That's a quartet. Do you notice where they're playing? Yeah, in a winery. I hope they're finished. Because if not, this is really bad technique. Okay? And most importantly, culture is a creation of the human spirit. And because it's a creation of the human spirit, sharing it generates a human connection. We share food and wine. It is a tradition that goes back for at least 2,000 years. No? Leonardo da Vinci painted The Last Supper. It's a sharing of food and wine. By the way, he painted it wrong. what's wrong with Leonardo da Vinci's Last Supper? Anybody know? They're sitting, well, they're not all around the table. Yeah, they're all on one side. But also, they're sitting in chairs. The time of Christ, nobody sat in chairs. They ate lying down. No, he got it wrong. Leonardo da Vinci got it wrong. Yeah. But when we share food, when we share wine, we share conversation, we share our dreams, we have a communion, a coming together of people. Why do we lift our glasses when we make a toast? Because 3,000 years ago, before anyone else drank wine, we lifted the first cup to the heavens to ask for a blessing. We still do that today, 3,000 years later. We all do it together because it's a communion. It's sharing. This is experiential tourism. And you remember Marsha McLuhan, propaganda ends where dialogue begins. So we have to stop thinking about what we want tourists to see. We really need to show them this. No. We need to start asking, what do they want to see? Because I think you can ask any tourist and they will tell you, we don't want to see a bottling line. Yeah? We have to stop thinking us and what we're saying and start thinking them. What do they want to do? They have to become part of us. We need to make them part of the community. Instead of, we're the hosts and they're the guests, we need to say, as they say in Spanish, estás en tu casa. You are in your house. Our house is your house. I love this line from Mark Twain. Travel is fatal to prejudice, bigotry, and narrow-mindedness. And many of our people need it sorely on those accounts. If you have never read his book, Innocents Abroad, it's a very funny story of Mark Twain traveling around the world with a group of people from America who have never experienced anything outside of America, and he's very funny. So when we create as a winery, we create a visitor experience. We say, I want you to get the message. Remember yesterday we were talking about the brand message. It's important to have a brand message and communicate it. So we design our tourist experience to say, we want you to get this message. And the tourist says, I don't want to know about brands. I don't want to talk about marketing or branding. I want authenticity. I want personality. So somehow we have to solve that problem. But great tourist experiences do create that human connection. The only way to create a human connection is with another human. Remember my story yesterday about how all the journalists said no winery should ever show a video? Because the video is not a human connection. Which would be more powerful? A film showing Mount Etna erupting? Or perhaps an old woman from the village explaining how she felt when she watched the lava come down and destroy her house. Which would you remember more? Always you would remember the people more than the impersonal presentation. So, okay, we're going to talk about family tourism. That means children. In Napa Valley, there's a saying, we're not Disneyland. We're Disneyland for adults. We don't actually try to attract children. But there's an old rule in teaching. The attention span of your students is essentially 1 minute per year of age. I'm pushing it this morning because most of you are in your 20s and I'm going to talk for 45 minutes. So it's going to be difficult. And remember that when people are on vacation, they regress in age. They may be 60 years old when they leave home, but after the second day on the beach, they could be 9. I remember my family once had a large family reunion in Yosemite National Park. It was a wonderful vacation. We had a wonderful time, but I will never forget my two aunts, one who was 83 and the other who was 87, and they got into a screaming argument about who got to sit next to the window in the car. Okay. When we are on vacation, we regress in age. So we have to stop thinking that people have an attention span of an hour or 2 hours. Their attention span is 10 minutes. A video should never be more than 3 or 4 minutes. Everything has to be shorter, and children are exactly that way. You have to shorten everything you do if you want to entertain children. That's if you want to talk to them. Now, I have a simple solution to entertaining children. Water. I have raised 2 daughters. I know what I'm talking about. A small bowl of water, a small puddle of water, a small stream of water. Children are entertained for hours. Just saying. But children want to have fun. When they come to the winery, standing this high, listening to someone explain malolactic fermentation, that is not going to be fun in any way for any child. It's not fun for adults, so why should it be fun for children? So in some ways, families are easier to please, because all you have to do is give them water. But they're harder because we still want them to do what we say and not what they want to do. First of all, they're larger groups. Adults travel, one person, maybe 2 people, maybe 2 couples. But a family? I guarantee you, if there is a family of 5 and they are talking about where they are going to eat lunch, there will be at least 4 opinions. Okay? And 3 of the opinions will be absolutely unwilling to compromise in any way. So, not everybody is going to love everything. But there's an old rule. There's a saying in America, if mammy ain't happy, ain't nobody happy. Well, if the kids aren't happy, nobody's happy. So what do kids love? Water. Activities, adventures, they want to be entertained. This gets back to our comment that you should hire not enology students or art history students, you should hire theater students to work in your winery because they know how to entertain people. I love this photo here. No, one adult, a bunch of kids. Kids are having fun. Adults are doing something for them. Don't lecture me. Invite me to join you. Don't tell me how delicious your food is. Invite me to help you make it. Don't show me. Ask me to participate. This is a difficult thing for wineries to understand. The winemaker says, don't touch my wine. People want to. There's a winery in Napa, and it's a small winery, so they ferment everything in macro bins. You know what macro bins are? Yeah, big plastic cubes. And there's a sign in the tasting room that says, would you like us to help wine? Go wash your hands. So people go wash their hands and say, okay, I'm ready to help make wine. In the back, behind the tasting room, there are 35 macro bins. And the winemaker, reading a book. Tourists come out, he says, hello, would you like to help make wine? Yes, okay. Check. Number 27, do you see 27? Yeah, okay. Pull the top off. Okay, now push the grapes down. Okay? They start, no, no, come on, push everything in. Give it a good workout. Push all the grapes in. Okay? Go ahead. Are you done? You want to do 26? Okay. The people are delighted. They're taking pictures. One time there was an entire bus of Japanese tourists, all with their hands. No? And the winemaker? Reading a book. But that's a memorable experience because he invited them to participate. So don't educate me. Make me part of the family. I once visited a winery in Italy, and there were no children with the group, but the daughter of the owner was about 2 and a half. And she immediately came up to me, took my hand, my finger, and said, come on. She wanted to march me over to the cellar where there was the barrel that was her wine. They were making a wine in celebration of her, and she wanted to show me that wine. I will remember that for a long time. I cannot remember any other time anyone in a winery has shown me a barrel, but I remember that time. And it was that human connection of those tiny fingers and absolute determination. Come on. Make them part of your family. Yeah, don't make me an audience. Teach me to dance. I was in Africa 2 weeks ago. We were sitting around the dinner table and a group came in, basically the restaurant staff, and started dancing. And they danced for about 5 minutes and then they started pulling people out of their chairs to make them dance with them. It completely changed the atmosphere of the room. And in the end, all of the restaurant staff was sitting down clapping and all the guests were dancing in the middle of the restaurant. It was a wonderful experience. So what is culture? Music is a higher revelation than all wisdom and philosophy. Beethoven was once asked what he was saying with his Fifth Symphony, the famous symphony, da-da-da-da, and he said, if I could explain it in words, I wouldn't have to write the symphony. Wonderful quote. Or Plato, there is geometry in the humming of the strings. There is music in the spacing of the spheres. We have to communicate this sense of culture. We have to communicate not just what we do in the winery, but how we see the world. And of course, culture is ultimately a shared human experience. Anybody know what that is? Somebody from Tarragona knows what this is, right? You're from Penedès. Yeah. A huge celebration of vin jazz, it's called, no? Yeah. Huge celebration of music in the heart of Penedès. I love this wine from Flaubert. Travel makes one modest. You see what a tiny place you occupy in the world. That's why we travel, to see a completely different side of life. So what's the next step? If you'll allow me to quote Mr. Machado, caminante no hay camino, se hace camino al andar. For wineries, if you are going to create a new tourist experience, you are going to have to make the path as you walk, because there is no road for you to follow. Is wine tourism for families? You have to answer this. Before you start, you have to decide, is this a good thing or not? There are some wineries, Chateau Latour, Chateau Lafitte Rothschild. There is no reason to bring a 5-year-old child to Chateau Latour or Chateau Lafitte Rothschild. And here is an essential problem. Most wineries, even though they want to sell wine, even though they want to provide a tourism experience, even though they want to be friendly, in their deepest, darkest heart, they want to be Chateau Lafite Rothschild. They want to make wine and have the world come to the door, get on their knees and say, please, could I have one bottle? And the problem is, that's not the way it works. It may work that way in 250 years, but Chateau Lafite Rothschild has been making wine for 250 years and they have earned that reputation. A new winery cannot think that way, because there are some problems with wineries as tourists. They don't buy as much because they have to buy lunch for the children, they have to buy an extra hotel room for the children, they're spending money on other things. They will not buy 24 bottles of wine. They may buy one bottle or two bottles. But if you can make them part of your family, not just sell them one or two bottles of wine, but make them part of your family, there are wineries in Napa who have guests today, visitors today, who are 25 years old, who say, I first remember my mom telling me she came here with her grandpa. And if you can build that connection with the family, you're going to be successful. So, on the one hand, pure production facility. We make wine, we either ship it in bulk or we ship it to a distributor. No visitors, no contact, nothing. Production facility. On the other end, a tourist destination, completely focused on attracting visitors. Somewhere in this spectrum is where you have to decide you belong. And it should be a conscious decision. So I have five wineries here for you to look at. Notice they come from different places. Sonoma, Minnesota. We make wine in all 50 states in the United States, so one of the wineries is in Minnesota. There's a winery in Rioja, which I am expecting you to visit at one point or another as part of this program. There's a winery in Virginia, and finally, a winery in Napa. And I'm going to talk to you about what each one of these wineries does and why. And the first one is owned by someone you might have heard of before. Has anyone heard of Francis Ford Coppola? I think he made a movie or two. This is his winery in Sonoma. Now I need to explain, he has a winery in Napa. It's not for children. But in Sonoma, he has created a destination for families. It has a swimming pool. Remember what I said about water? It has a swimming pool, a restaurant. He views this winery as a place for people to go and spend the day with their family and enjoy life in the country. Okay? But remember, he's a movie producer. He has a different vision than most winemakers. Most winemakers would have a very difficult time saying, I think we should build a swimming pool for our guests. That's just going to make most winemakers say, whoa, 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 whoa. I would rather have another tank or some more barrels or maybe one more vineyard. But Francis Ford Coppola said, no, this is my attempt to show people what hospitality can be like. And swimming pool, restaurant, and here's what's quite wonderful. He goes there with his family. You can be sitting by the pool and look over and... that's Francis Ford Coppola. Sitting there, it's a little round, no? Having a glass of wine, having a little food, sitting by the pool, enjoying it along with everybody else. He's really quite an interesting man, and you should look for a YouTube video where he is interviewed by a famous journalist on how wine and movies are similar. And it's wonderful for two reasons. One of them is he does a wonderful job of explaining you begin in each case with the raw materials, the script, and the actors, the grapes and the barrels. And then you begin the production. You ferment the wine, you film the actors. But then there's the post-production. Which scene do we use? Which part of this do we take? Exactly the same in wine. Which barrels do we use? How do we finish it? And then, he says, you watch the movie, gives you pleasure, you drink the wine, it's also a pleasurable experience. It's a really good interview, but at the same time, one of the things that I think is wonderful about this, the man doing the interview asks the question, and he is so excited about Francis Ford Coppola's being on stage with him that as Francis is talking, he pulls out his phone and starts videotaping him as he was doing the interview. Wonderful stuff. So that is one opportunity. That is one way of creating wine tourism. But I don't think there are very many wineries that have this kind of courage. Because that really means you are going out on a limb. They have a swimming pool. They have bocce. You know what bocce is? What is it in Spanish? In French, it's pétanque. Pétanque? Okay, yeah. They have a movie exhibit. They have restaurants. They have a scavenger hunt, a treasure hunt for people over 21 that you run around the winery trying to find clues, trying to solve mysteries, you win a bottle of wine. Children are welcome at the winery, but nowhere in their marketing do they say anything about children. Okay. Do you like the car? Yeah, that's from his movies. This is a winery in Minnesota, Carlos Creek Winery. The owner, it was actually a very high-level marketing executive from a bank, a large multinational bank. And she and her husband bought this ranch. It is nowhere in Minnesota. Who's from Minnesota? Somebody was from Minnesota. Alexandria, Minnesota. 2.5 hours from St. Paul. So it's nowhere. They say wine should be welcoming, fun, and most importantly, really, really good. They invited me to come visit their winery, and I did an analysis of their winery. They showed me every vineyard. We tasted through all the wines. And then they showed me the facilities they have for tourism. And when we were finished, I said, I have excellent news for you. They said, what's that? I said, you don't own a winery. What? I said, you don't own a winery. What you own is a tourist destination, but it's an extremely successful one. And so what you should do is stop worrying about being a winery and continue to be a really good tourist destination. So they do weddings. They have a beautiful room to do weddings. They charge $5,000 to $10,000 a day for their weddings, just for the facility. Okay? They do 50 weddings a year. So they are making between $250,000 and $500,000 a year just renting the room. Then they do catering, then they sell the wine, then this is magic. This is free money. You know? They have a horseshoe court. You know horseshoes where you throw the horseshoes? It's the Wild West version of pétanque, right? Yeah. They have live music, concerts all the time. They do murder mysteries. They do an evening or a presentation like this, and all of a sudden someone in the corner goes, ah, and dies. And now we have to figure out who did it. Was it Jaume with the knife? No, I don't know. Who was paying attention? They're fun. They do a grape stomp. They put the grapes in a half barrel. They have a competition to see who can stomp the grapes the best. 15,000 people attend the grape stomp. They bring in six mobile phone hotspot vans. And they crash because they have so much social media traffic that day. This is phenomenally successful. Everyone pays to get in, they pay to buy food, they pay to drink wine, there is music, there are horseshoes, everything you can, 15,000 people a day. They do family-oriented, self-guided tours. They don't show the vineyard, but they do show the horses. They walk through the barrels, but they allow people to nibble on the grapes because it's for families. It's not just for wine people. So it's really a tourist destination first that happens to have a winery. But once you start thinking that way, then the question is not what new wine should we make, which is the problem with most wineries. They start a winery with three wines, and the first question they ask is, the winemaker wants to make Malvasia. Now the winemaker wants to make Monastrell. Now the winemaker wants to make a blend of Malvasia and Monastrell with bubbles. No, nobody's asking for this stuff. But once you decide we're a tourist destination, should we offer food? Should we have picnic tables? Should we have a swimming pool? Should we have a wedding hall? Should we have, now you start thinking about things that actually make money. Trust me, a blend of Malvasia and Monastrell with bubbles will not make money. Now we go to Rioja. Who's been to Dinastia Vivanco? Yeah, did you like it? What is the most important part of Dinastia Vivanco, would you say? The museum. It's a spectacular museum. Possibly the greatest wine museum in the world. No? There's a whole floor just for barrels and how you make them, and a whole floor for glassware. It's beautiful. It's fun. But what's this? It's giant grapes. What else is it? It's a playground. Kids can climb around on this and go down the slide and crawl into the grapes because the museum is five full floors. And believe me, no child is going to want to go through five full floors, but they can go outside and play on the grapes. They also have a wonderful exhibit, Wine and the Movies. They even published a book about wine and the movies. Sometime when this program has endless hours of instruction, I will come back and do, I have a lecture on wine and literature, wine and the movies, wine and art, wine and music, and it will give you a different perspective. But Dinastia Vivanco does this very well. They have the museum. Kids are invited, and kids are invited not just to play in the playground, they have creativity workshops for children. So while you are visiting the winery, your child can be in an art studio, for little kids, but it's an art studio, where they can play with things and create art. And of course, some of the themes have to do with grapes. They have a restaurant, they have the playground, they publish their own books. So they literally aim at families as a target market. They want families to come there because they believe that becoming part of their family makes you part of the visitor's family, and then you sell a lot more wine. What wonderful family if you get a chance to talk to them. This one's great. Barrel Oak Winery in Virginia. The owner of this went to the same university I went to in California, and he has a very different vision of what a winery is. Some of his neighbors in Virginia are not happy about this, but he is extremely successful. It is a dog-friendly winery. Remember that Barrel Oak Winery is B-O-W, bow. So he has bow wow events for dogs. They have live music. They have sweet treat weekends where you come and have delicious treats with their sweet wines, and your dogs get treats for them too. They have an oyster celebration because Virginia is close to the east. They're close to the eastern coast, so they get wonderful oysters. They have a pizza celebration. My favorite element of Bao Winery is on all of, there is, of course, a winery dog. A golden retriever, big, dumb, friendly golden retriever, right? And during all of their events at the winery, he has a GoPro camera on his head. And so as he walks around the winery and everybody says, there is a live web feed on their website. And so you see endless, endless hours of people going, right there in front of you. Does this not create a personality and character for the winery? Absolutely. Do they seem friendly? Absolutely. Do they seem welcoming? Absolutely. Do you feel like we could go there with our kids? Absolutely. Very smart marketing. Very good guys. And this is the winery that created the winery definition ordinance in Napa Valley. The owner's name is Dario Satui. His grandfather had a small winery in Napa, very small, about 150 square meters, small winery. It was abandoned. It was in the family, but nobody paid any attention. Dario eventually went on and organized some small delis, shops in Los Angeles, made some money, and said, you know, I should go up and organize a little bit with that winery in Napa. So he went there, and he looked at all the other wineries, and all the other wineries in Napa were doing exactly the same thing. You could have a tour, and you could have a tasting. And he said, people want a picnic. It's the wine country. So instead of investing in tanks or barrels or rotary fermenters, he invested in a lawn. He planted about half a hectare of grass, and he put some tables there. And in his tasting room, he had a small tasting bar, six wines. The wines were purchased. He didn't make them. He purchased them in bulk, bottled them there, and the rest of his 150 square meters was a deli. Wonderful bread, wonderful salami, wonderful cheese, olives, everything you need for a picnic. Only one rule. If you're going to picnic on my lawn, you have to drink my wine. Okay? People in Napa were outraged. They said, this is not a winery. He's not making wine. But he had all the permits. He had done everything absolutely by the book. And what was wonderful, in my mind, all the wineries were outraged, not because he did it. They were outraged because he was violently successful. You would drive past Robert Mondavi Winery and Louis Martini Winery, and the parking lots would be empty, but the lawn at Satui was packed. He had to expand parking. By the way, he had a permit for weddings. There is only one winery in Napa that is allowed to hold weddings, Dario Satui. So, you see the beautiful wine building there? Isn't that beautiful? Huh? He built that about 15 years ago. He paid cash. He paid cash because he had made so much money in his picnic area. He sells 1 million bottles of wine a year out of his picnic area. They have picnics, they have a delicatessen, they have weddings, they have a private party. It doesn't, the winery doesn't really deliver wines. It delivers experiences, but it does so perfectly. It is the most successful direct-to-consumer winery in America and possibly the world because they offer picnics. So, wine tourism essentials. Here are the key success factors. You have to have clear goals. It's not enough to say we welcome families. If there's nothing for the kids to do, it won't be successful. You have to understand what you're gaining and what you're losing. I loved Roger's presentation yesterday about the Puño Blanco label. And he said, I love this label. And I thought, good. But not everyone is going to love that label. If marketing is about being different, you have to understand that when you are different, you will attract some people and you will drive other people away. And that's okay. You don't need everybody. The worst marketing of all is we're everything to everybody. Because in the end, you're nothing to nobody. But remember that when you select for one group, you are probably driving another group away. Understand that before you decide we're going to only focus on families. And ultimately, there is only one way to work in the wine industry, and that's to play to win. People in the wine industry like to say, oh, we're one big happy family, but that may be true. Your job is to be more successful than anybody else, and that means doing it better than anybody else. Remember my SWOT diagram from yesterday. You have to do this better than the competition. The only way you know you're working is when they're unhappy. Questions? Not a single question. We have a problem because I'm supposed to give you, and I did, I'm supposed to give you about a half an hour to ask questions. And if there are no questions, this is going to be a long, slow half hour. And Rioja.
Here in Priorat, we have completely different landscapes, completely different wineries. So I think there's something that it's really good, but how do you integrate these kind of things into those wineries that we are? That they are little, that we don't have too much space to make these parking lots, to make all those things. How you think it's the best way to create something like this, or if you think that we can create something like this in Priorat too? Mm-hmm.
Great, great question. And so first of all, you have to work with what you have. You do not have, Robert Mondavi has an auditorium, a big room in his winery that's almost this big, just for events. No? Yeah. Not in Priorat. But if the goal is to attract families, what can you do? It doesn't have to happen at the winery. Remember Burning Man. So I was talking to the gentleman from Slovenia yesterday. And we were talking about a friend, one of my students in Slovenia. He organizes a bicycle ride. It's a big bicycle ride from Ljubljana to his winery. It's about 100 kilometers. You know, too big for families. But there's a 20K. There's a 40K. There's a 100K. You can organize a walk through the vineyards with the family. You can have a naturalist. I hope that word is translated correctly into Spanish, because that's someone who understands the natural world. It is not someone who walks around with no clothes on, okay? In English, that's a naturist. A naturalist is someone who is a student of nature. And lead them, you can have an event where they go through the vineyards, and you can explain the birds, the butterflies, the flowers, and how things happen. In our national parks, we have a wonderful program in the States called the Junior Ranger Program. And you have to identify five animals, and you have to identify two trees, and you have to tell a story about your experience in the park. It's a little workbook. And when you finish the workbook, you get a certificate signed by a ranger. The children have to take a pledge to protect the park. It's very cute. No? They get a little badge, Junior Ranger, and now they're part of the protecting system of the park. This is great. We can do this in the wine business. In Trapani, where is my friend from Sicily? In Trapani, I was given a tour once of the local cathedral. And I noticed in another part of the room, another part of the building, there was a child giving a tour, 12 years old. And I said to my hostess, I said, isn't that illegal? That's a child working there. She says, no, it's the best program we do in Trapani. When children are 12 years old in Trapani, they are asked to adopt a historic monument in the province of Trapani. They are to write a report on it, to study it, and then they have to give three tours. A tour to their family, a tour to the other students in the class, and finally, a tour to a group of strangers. He's doing the tour to the group of strangers. She's explaining this to me, and I'm saying, this is a really good idea. And a man walked by who was about the age of our students here, 25, 30 years old. And he said, yes. He says, it's a wonderful program. This is my building. When I was 12, I had the cathedral. Now, if you have children growing up saying, this is my building, this is my winery, this is my vineyard, you're doing something right, because that will pay dividends for generations. And all of those you can do, even if your winery doesn't have a room big enough to have a conference or a wedding. But you have to think about events out in the community. Okay? We had another question in the back, I thought. Did I see someone's hand all the way in the back? No? It wasn't you. Okay, yeah, you're sitting. Well, okay. Here, we have a couple more.
Hi. So what do you think about the wineries that make activities for children on one side and then for parents on the other side? They're not together, maybe.
Right. If you can do it, it's a lovely system. You have to be a little careful, because as a winery, one of the things you are taught in business school, what's the first rule of expanding your business? Stick to your core competency. If your core competency is making wine and you open a daycare center, that may not be your core competency. So you have to be careful that if you are providing care and supervision for those children, it has to be very professionally done. Because if the parents come out and little Maria is sitting, I broke my finger, now you have a big problem. So it's possible. There are wineries that do it. Dinastia Vivanco has the Children's Creativity Center. They have a professional child, a children's teacher, a primary teacher there, instructing the children and helping them do the artwork and all the rest. It works very well. But if the man who works in the cellar has a daughter who's 13 and she can watch the children, That would terrify me. Not because she wouldn't try, but you need a professional in place in order to do that. You need to be able to say, we were careful, we understand the concern. I will never forget the day I took my daughter, she was 8, to summer camp. She was going to spend 1 week at a camp where they spoke only Spanish. Okay? She now speaks fluent Spanish, unfortunately with an Argentine accent, but fluent Spanish. And I remember we arrived, and they organized this as if you were traveling to a different country. It was an immersion program for children. So we arrived, they confiscated all of her English books. She had to have a passport, a little paper passport. She had to go through customs where they took her books. She had to go to the health inspector where they took her medical records. She had to go to the bank to change her $3 into play money for the camp. We're halfway through this and I'm thinking, this is a nightmare. No? And she's holding my hand, she looks up, she says, Dad, isn't this great? But I will never forget when we were done, we put her in the little cabin, put her clothes away, she got into her bathing suit, and we took her to the pool. And there was a young woman, 18 years old, who was the lifeguard. And I was saying goodbye to my daughter for a week in the pool. And I said to the lifeguard, I said, please watch her. You have my life in your hands. So when you say, yes, we provide these activities for children, remember, you have the parent's life in your hands. Other questions? Here we had one. We had one in here too, didn't we?
Good morning. Thank you for the presentation. I have a clear question. You said in one slide that families tend to spend less. How do I explain this to the shareholders and sell this idea? How would be like 3 points, like arguments, clear, like we have to do this for families? It's difficult to explain this in numbers, for example.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a great question. And the answer is the reason we're doing this is because we need to sell more. The current group of customers we have is not buying enough. We need to expand. So even though families buy less, we will get more customers by inviting more families. So in that way, we may be selling less per customer, but more total volume. If you can make that argument, great. The other argument, of course, is they may spend less today. But in time, if we make them part of our family, they will become long-term family or company members. Yeah. Yes.
With some of the visits in the biggest wineries, as well as the small wineries, the biggest wineries, when I meet the PR and other department heads, they always have the argument put forward that they do not get enough amount of budget for wine tourism because the financial officer doesn't get what are the benefits. They require tangible benefits. Fortunately and unfortunately, wine tourism is more of intangible benefits. It's very hard to explain to the financial controllers. And also the small winery do not have enough cash flows. So what would be the argument I can put forward if I'm going to work with the small wineries, also the bigger wineries? Because the medium-sized wineries always wanted to explore these niche category of wine tourism because yeah. They can build the brand.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, with the bigger and the smaller, has a problem of cash flow or the benefits. So
I always answer that question with Visatui Winery. Because Visatui Winery sells 1 million bottles of wine direct to consumer at full price, no discount for distribution, at an average price of about $30 a bottle, $30 million of revenue. I want to hear your financial officer explain to me that you cannot do that because you don't want $30 million of revenue.
they don't want actually to invest more because they wanted to sell more in the export market, not with the tourism. So I'm thinking, like, how do I convince them? Because for them, getting $1 million in tourism and on-premise compared to their export sales or the sales in the national can be very higher. So how do we convince the bigger guys?
So Constellation Wines, not a small wine company, the second largest wine company in the world, operates two massive visitor centers in the Napa Valley. One of them is Robert Mondavi Winery. One of them is The Prisoner. And their expectation is not only are they building brand equity and brand awareness, they are making significant amounts of money in those facilities. Mum Cuvée Napa, which I think is now owned by Treasury, they have a wine club with 15,000 members. 15,000 members, the wine club, the average member ends up buying 3 cases of wine per year. So that's 45,000 cases of wine per year. I would be interested to know which distributors in the world sell 45,000 cases of wine for Mum Cuvée Napa. And when you explain that to the financial people, they start nodding.
So the visit was happened maybe 1 week ago, and had a huge discussion with the PR. And he had the same issue that we are not getting enough funds, and he wasn't able to try to convince them.
Yeah.
Because United States market, it's mostly driven by the marketing and the tourism. But
sometimes.
Yes. But in Spain, wherever the wineries I visited, maybe just 4 or 5, they have a different philosophy.
Yes.
The smallest one, they say, we don't want visitors. And the biggest ones, they say, we want visitors, but we are not getting funds.
Right. So, and I would say, to freshen it, it's because you're doing it wrong. No? I would point to La Rioja Alta, not the region, but the winery. La Rioja Alta S.A. Okay? They have a wine club, 5,000 members. Each member buys 20 cases of wine. So 100,000 cases of wine sold to their wine club. What are they doing different than Freshenet? Freshenet says we want everybody all the time, and our hospitality center is primarily a public relations exercise. La Rioja Alta says we want buying customers, and our visitor center is primarily an outlet for direct-to-consumer sales. Freshenet does not try to sell wine, they only try to tell their market position, their stories to the consumer, but I think it's very badly organized in terms of actually selling wine. And for example, the person who gives you your tour at Freshenet, at the end of the tour, bye-bye. And then you go to the sales room. Who is in the sales room? A bunch of people you've never met. If you want to sell wine, the tour guide should be in the tasting room saying, do you remember when you tasted that on the tour? This is that wine. Do you remember when you mentioned to me that your daughter is getting married? This is the wine for the wedding. They don't do that. They leave enormous amounts of money on the table.
All right, thanks.
Other questions? Okay, we still have 15 minutes. Oh, here's, thank goodness, we've got one here. I've already told you the best tour and the worst tour, so I can't tell you one of the tour stories again.
Hi. So your Minnesota example reminded me of a wine region in California called Temecula.
Yep.
So it's halfway between LA and San Diego.
Yes.
It's a tourist trap.
It is.
Winemakers have admitted to me that they don't feel pressure to make better wine because it's
it
for tourists.
It all sells.
So my question is, how do you become a destination without compromising the essence and the authenticity that you mentioned is important in the beginning?
Okay. So what was the essence of Temecula to begin with?
It's like the Las Vegas of wine in a sense. But they could become a winemaking region that's respected for its wine. That's essence to me.
They could. The question you have to ask before all of that is, what's the goal? And I'm going to argue that too many people get into the wine industry with the goal of saying, I want to be Chateau Latour, or even more focused, I want to be Petrus. No?
Yeah.
I want to make wine, and it will be so lovely that people will buy the wine, and I never have to talk to them. And I would say, you know, at Napa Valley College, we offer 3 degrees. We offer a degree in viticulture, a degree in enology, and a degree in wine marketing and sales. So people who are getting into the business have a vineyard. They take the viticulture class. They get the degree. They understand what's going on in the vineyard. They're really growing good grapes. The problem is they're not getting paid for them enough. But it's not a problem, because they can turn those grapes into wine and make even more money. So then they take the enology classes, and they learn all about enology, and they start making wine, and the wine is very, very good, but it's not selling. So then they come and take my class. And usually it's about 1 hour into the first lecture that somebody raises their hand and says, why don't you make us take this class first? Because if you don't have a plan on how it's going to finish, getting started is going to be a mistake. Temecula started without a plan. And they are where they are because they still have no plan. The challenge that Temecula has, if it's a challenge, the wine sells. Everything sells, people are making money, what's not to like? Is there any character or personality to the region? Not really. Everybody makes what they want. Everybody has a few customers they like. They are in the middle of 20 million potential customers. And if you can't sell wine when you're sitting in the middle of a vineyard with a cute little winery within 45 minutes of 20 million people, you should be shot. And that's Temecula. I'm not sure there's an easy solution to that one. But at least they're making money. The ones I feel sorry for are the ones who start in a new region, far from an urban center. And they go through the same process, and they open the doors, and nobody walks in the door. No. I do an exercise with my students. How much does the average tourist buy? Average tourist in a taste room buys one bottle. Now, how many of you have worked in a winery tasting room? Yeah. Do they buy one bottle? They buy more. 3. Yeah. Here's the problem. They're usually with other people. So the sale is for 3 bottles, but the 3 bottles is for the person, his girlfriend, and maybe somebody else. So even if we say average 2 bottles per customer, you have a small amount of wine. You have, let's say, 5,000 bottles of wine total to sell. It's not a big winery. If you have 5,000 bottles to sell, how many customers do you need? 2 it's 2 bottles per customer. I'm sure somebody can do this math. You need 2,500 customers, right? How many is that per day? About 8. You need 8 customers a day. Now you have a measurable plan. How are we going to get 8 buying customers per day? And the problem is, on a rainy day in October, are you going to get 8 customers? No. Which means in July, you need 16. And so now, how are we going to get 16 customers per day? And it's really how you have to approach the business. Not selling enough wine? What can we do? Get more customers. Where do we get more customers? Who brought the last customers here? That taxi driver. Get him on the phone. Ask him if his daughter is going to college. Can we help in any way? But get him on the phone and get him to bring us more customers. Yeah. So if you learn to quantify that out, it's really quite amazing. One of the things I love to do with my students, many of my students say, we're going to start small. We're only going to make 300 cases, 3,600 bottles of wine. I say, great, where are you going to sell it? Oh, mainly in restaurants. I said, good, here's 12 cases of wine. Go sell the wine. How easy is it to sell 12 cases of wine? And they come back after a couple of days and say, this is really hard. I said, I know, and you're going to do this 25 times, not just once, but for 300 cases, 25 times. It's important that you understand the scalability of this business and start with a plan. Did you have more?
Yeah. Do you think that the destination strategy is applicable in somewhere like Spain, with so much history, without ruining the authenticity and the essence?
Yes. I think it's applicable everywhere. The question is, what kind of experience will you have? And it's important to give people that kind of experience. I don't see Francis Ford Coppola in Priorat. Sorry, I just don't see the swimming pool, barbecue, restaurant kind of thing. Isn't going to happen. But a small winery that has two small rooms that they can rent, and maybe a small little cafe where you can have lunch and some picnic tables, I could see that. And if that happens and more people start staying, it never happens overnight. But start small, start measurable, and as you measure, see how you're growing and always plan for the next step. I will tell you that whoever takes the first big step will be, first of all, ridiculed, and then when it turns out that it's working very well, hated, and then after about 5 years, copied. Innovation in the wine industry is watching somebody else do it for about 3 years and being absolutely convinced it'll work and then saying, I'm going to be innovative. Yeah. Another question here. They're getting you a mic. Right here.
This is a question that you are telling that wine tourism doesn't exist. Tourism does exist.
Yeah.
And this is a three-part question. The first part question is, during the lectures we had in the last 1 month and a half, and they're saying there is over-tourism in Barcelona. Yesterday, there was a presentation by Reus. They're saying that 3% in Diu Tarragona, people only visit, and 1% in Terra Alta, which means that people are not moving from Barcelona to this region.
And as
we are not, there is no category called wine tourism exist till date. So what would be the practical solution? Since you see Penedès and Priorat occupies almost 70% of wine tourism, just to reach regions. And Terra Alta, obviously, because of grape varietal, Granacha Blanca, and Diu Tarragona because of quality. How do you drive the crowd from Barcelona? It's a practical question, you know, to make sure that. How do you drive them from Barcelona to these two regions, which has low potential, low visitors?
Okay. So one of the people I met at Espai Priorat was a man named Roger Philippe, and he specializes in cooking over an open fire. And he does special meals for groups of visitors. If you were to go to the top hotels in Barcelona, there are two challenges. You have to offer something really remarkable, and you have to make it easy. So, he offers something really remarkable. He cooks paella and other things on an open fire. You know Roger, no? Yeah. And it's a marketable product to tourists. Now the question is, how do we make it easy for them to get there? And that's an infrastructure problem. That's a completely separate problem. But I would give you an example. Who's from Mendoza? Yeah. Where are the wineries in Mendoza? Valeuco. And how far is Valeuco from Mendoza? Yeah. And are the wineries in Valeuco right next to each other? No, they're all over the place. Someone who goes to Mendoza and says, I'm here to visit wineries, is in for a big surprise. Because if you're going on foot, it's going to take you days. And if you're going to hire a taxi, so there's a woman who started a program. It's very simple, very smart. She has a small bus, 20 passengers, and she does a route every Monday, Wednesday, Friday, visits three wineries, includes lunch. She picks you up in 15 different locations in Mendoza. So you don't have to go to the main bus station or the main, she will pick you up any hotel you're at. By the way, you will be on time, because if you are not on time, she will leave you behind. And the first two Swedish passengers who were left behind at the hotel, they never missed another bus. She goes, and everything's included. You pay her, she goes, she takes you to three wineries. On Tuesdays and Thursdays and Saturdays, she visits a different selection of wineries. So you can spend 2 days in Mendoza, visit six or seven wineries, two different meals, all organized, all you do is you're part of the bus. It's a brilliant solution. She has a tour guide on the bus who tells you about Mendoza. She identifies the peaks of the Andes as you're driving along the highway. It's a brilliant system. It did not work financially at first. She couldn't charge the customers enough to make it pay. And then she went to the 15 hotels and she said, $20 a day to pick up at your hotel. And the hotel said, and she said, okay, I'll go pick up at the other hotel. You tell your customers if they want to get on my bus, they have to walk two blocks down and get on the bus at the other hotel. All the hotels paid. So now she has subsidies from the hotels. She went to the wineries and said, excuse me, I'm bringing you 20 customers every day. I think I should get a little something for that. Now, it actually pays for itself, it makes money, and she's setting up a second bus with a second set of wineries to do the routes. So it is possible. It takes somebody with real vision, takes somebody with real persistence, and it takes someone with real patience. She's a remarkable person, but it's a brilliant solution. It could work perfectly for Priorat. We pick you up in Barcelona, we deliver you at 8 o'clock that night, and in the meantime, we deliver you to four wonderful, wonderful wineries in Priorat, or Tarragona, or Terralta, or wherever. And it could include a meal cooked by Roger over his open fire, and you would have people raving about this activity. It would be TripAdvisor's top five. Sagrada Familia, drinking, Priorat. I once had an interview with the director of tourism for the city of Barcelona. And he was talking to me and he said, how do you like Barcelona? I said, I love it, but I have to ask a question. He said, when I go to Madrid, there's the Prado, there's the Reina Sofia, there's the Thyssen Museum, you're very close to Avila, Segovia, Toledo. I mean, it has a million things to do. I said, in Barcelona, there's the Sagrada Familia. And he said, and there's walking around and eating and drinking. And I said, yeah. I said, that's really, he says, that's all there is to do. And people love it. And he's right. Because when people are on vacation, four museums isn't necessarily better than three. Sometimes one museum is all you need, because what you really want to do when you're on vacation is walk around, stop in at La Boqueria, grab some calamari, have a vermouth, sit on the beach, sit on the La Rambla and watch the people go by, order another tapa, and when you get back to your hotel, you think, that was a really nice day. That's vacation. Other questions? Yes.
I'm from Priorat. We were talking yesterday regarding what you were saying about this bus departing from Barcelona and doing all these tours. We already started something like this some years ago. It didn't work. We were doing this with Diputació de Barcelona, so we were doing it with the tourist board. As you said, maybe we needed more than passions. I would say we need invest of money.
Yes.
At the beginning, so we could just be pouring money there, waiting for it to come back.
Yeah.
We didn't have it, and nobody was supporting that anyway, so we had to stop that.
Yeah.
As we are sustainability is also quite an important issue nowadays, and more our travelers are concerned about that. One of the ways we are attracting people to Priorat as we are doing the wine tours is telling them to come by train.
Uh-huh.
We'll get lots of American tourists and also from other regions. We notice that for American tourists, it's a bit difficult sometimes to just think they can step into a train and travel.
They've never been on a train before.
But, I mean, one of the main reasons it's price. If they have to get a private transfer, price are really high.
Yeah.
So, I don't know, what do you think about that, about how can we try to find other regions, so we can drive people using a train, using a type of transports that are more affordable.
Yeah.
And they also are great. I mean, in terms of scenery, it's beautiful to be on this train trip.
Yeah.
So do you think this is something that could be enhanced or could be positive in the future, or we should try to solve the transfer issue with the bus or something like this, which is pretty difficult from my point of view.
And I should say, the woman who organized this bus program in Mendoza, for the first 18 months, she drove the bus herself. She gave the tour herself. And it was all her money. And that's why I say she's a remarkable person. It really took a long time to develop that. I think trains can work, but if I wanted to organize train tourism to Priorat, wouldn't it be great if a certain section of a car on the train was just reserved for wine tourists to Priorat? And you had this gentleman on the train saying, during the ride up to Priorat, I'm going to tell you a few stories about Priorat. That would transform the train from, am I afraid, do I know what I'm doing, to, oh, look, it says Priorat right here. Oh, and here's my friend, and he's saying hello, and he's telling me. It would be magic, absolutely magic. Yeah.
We have two problems here. One is the railway company,
Oh, I understand.
And the other one is that most of the visitors, they want a private tour. So they want to be 2 or 4 people with a guide. So they don't want to be joining any group.
That's
another reason. It wouldn't work.
I love the idea of the Priorat Express. Who else? All the way in the back. All the way from Slovenia.
Okay, so we are talking about creation of the experience all the time. But how do you find the communication? A lot of time we can see that somebody has created the product which stands on its own, and nobody is talking about this product. It's just there.
Yeah.
How do you see, let's say, regions in the world, maybe in comparison to Napa Valley?
Yeah, great question, because I'm a marketing person. The product is only the first step. whether it's wine or whether it's tourism, the fact that you've created a product is all very nice. Unless you're going to be able to sell that product effectively, you've got nothing. And so let's talk about how tourists plan. How do tourists decide where they are going to go? What do they do? Who do they talk to? Okay, this is an MBA in wine tourism, right? You guys are supposed to know this stuff. How do tourists begin to plan their visits? Social media, internet, which is more likely to begin with? When they sit down and decide, okay, time to plan our vacation. They talk to their friends and family. They get on a desktop or a laptop, not their phone. Phone comes later, you know, because they really want to see it on the big screen and see all the options. And they start picking and choosing. If you're not appearing there, the long-term planning is going to disappear. When you go to Mendoza and start talking about visiting wineries, this woman's bus service is right up there with SEO. Make it easy. Step on our bus. But then there's a second level to that. People are in Mendoza. How do they plan their tourism once they get to Mendoza? Where do they eat? What do they use to find where they're going to eat? Maybe they ask the hotel. I will tell you, I have never owned a phone that when you pulled up the recent searches, one of the recent searches wasn't restaurants near me. Because it's how we live our lives these days. So that's the second element of this. It's all well and good to talk to hotel concierges and all the rest. But man, you had better be where people find you on the phone. So I have a horror story to tell you. We did work for years for the fire marshal of Napa County, a really smart lady who was in charge of all firefighters in the county. She was so good that she eventually became the assistant fire marshal for the state of California. So, big promotion. And she called me about a year later. She said, I have an idea for you. I said, great, come on down, Jane. So she comes down to my office and she says, let me tell you what we're working on in the state fire program. We have a GIS program that gives us real-time information on every fire incident everywhere in the state of California, and it gives exact GPS coordinates for every incident. I looked at this and I said, what would Paul Wagner do with this? If we set it up, instead of reporting what fires exist in the state of California, what if it reported all the tourist activities in the Napa Valley? So a tourist could arrive in the Napa Valley, open their phone, and get real-time information. At 10:15 at Robert Mondavi Winery, there is a tasting of 7 Merlots. At 10:45 at this winery, there is a presentation on wine and the history of art. And blah, 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 you could get instantaneous, immediate information for every tourist activity in the Napa Valley. She said, wouldn't that be great? And I said, yes, it would. She said, do you think we can sell this? And I said, no, I don't. She said, why? And I said, because wineries can't be bothered to tell people what they're doing. They will organize a tasting and they will put it on their website, but the idea that they'll actually take the time to send a note to every journalist doesn't happen. They will take the time to go on the calendar of events for the region and put it, doesn't happen. Wineries are terrible at this. The only people who are worse, restaurants. We have a special dinner with the winemaker. Who are you telling? Oh, there's a poster in the restaurant. Excellent. The people who eat here tonight are told they can come back tomorrow night and eat the same thing all over again. That's not your market. So it's a huge problem because it's not that hard, but somebody actually has to do it. Wineries don't do it. Restaurants don't do it. If they did it, it would work. In my other life, what I do for vacation, what I do for holidays, when I'm a tourist, I go backpacking. Not just hiking. You know, hiking with a backpack, and we go out for 3, 4, 5 days carrying everything we need, and we live in the mountains for 5 days, no other people, carrying our food, carrying our tent, no cell phone coverage, no internet. It's the perfect contrast to the way I live the rest of my life. And we love doing this. So I created a website on backpacking in the Sierra Nevada mountains of California. It's called Backpack the Sierra. If you go on to Google and Google backpacking the Sierra Nevada, guess who has the number one SEO on Google? Me. Because I go on every few days, except when I'm in Spain or Africa or something, and I add more information. But I work at it. And most wineries don't do it. It can be done, it will work, but you absolutely have to have someone dedicated to doing this all the time. And it's usually, well, someone who works in our visitor center, the person who works in the tasting room, when it's quiet, they can do that. That person is also, by the way, packing up wine to ship out, cleaning the glasses, washing the toilet, and doing everything else they're supposed to do. So you can imagine how much focus they have on this one. Or the winemaker says, I don't trust anyone else to speak for the winery. I will do it. And you know at that point it will never get done because it doesn't involve touching wine. So that's the problem. The solutions are easy. You need to be on Facebook. You need to be on Instagram. You need to put it on the local calendars. You need to send press releases to the local media. You need to send a note to the local concierges. You need to say hello to the local concierges and tell them why they need to open your emails. You need to talk to the other wineries in the region and tell them, hey, today we're doing something special. Tomorrow I will tell the people about your event. You need to talk to the restaurants to do it. It's not brain surgery, but you absolutely have to do it. And wineries, well, we just make really good wine. That's their solution. Other questions? You could clearly hit a nerve with that question. That was a good question. No other questions? Yes.
Tourist, that woman, what is the name of the thing she was doing in Mendoza?
I'm sorry, I don't remember her name, but if you give me 5 minutes at the break, I'll look it up.
Okay.
And we'll get it to you.
Thank you.
Smart lady. Yeah. Other questions? Going once? Going twice? Okay, sold. Thank you.